Sister, the other day, I gave her my right hand, and just as soon as ever my back was turned, she to scandalize my name. Now do you call that a sister? No, no. You call that a sister? No, no. Call that a sister? No, no. Scandalize my name. I met my preacher the other day, I gave him my right hand, just as soon as ever my back was turned, he to scandalize my name. Now do you call that religion? No, no. You call that religion? No, no. Call that religion? No, no. Scandalize my name.
Scandalize my name. That is exactly what the United States did. It scandalized the name of Paul Robeson, one of the most remarkable men who ever lived, anywhere, anytime. Who is Paul Robeson? What did he do? Why Paul Robeson? What does he have to offer to the contemporary black student? Paul Leroy Robeson, Sr. is to celebrate his 75th birthday this year. Despite the periodic reports in the New York Times about the late Paul Robeson, he is not dead, but living with his sister in Philadelphia, retired from public life as undefeated champion. This forgotten black hero was extraordinarily productive in the interpretive arts, on the screen, in the concert halls, on the stage. Extraordinarily productive in politics, extraordinarily productive in athletics, extraordinarily productive in scholarship. Most of these were important enough for any single career. Within recent months, many thousands young people in the 15 to 35 generation have been exposed to Paul Robeson for the first time. With a three-part Emmy Award series on national educational television, with the naming of the Paul Robeson Student Center at Rutgers, Newark, after persistent efforts of black students, with the revival of several Robeson films, with the reissuing of his major political statement, Here I Stand, and with the receipt of the Urban League's annual Whitney Young Memorial Award and the Black Psychiatrist's 1972 Award, Robeson has emerged from non-person to person. Drawing upon a panel of black historians, Ebony Magazine, in its August 1972 issue, voted Robeson one of the 10 most important blacks in the history of the United States. That this extraordinarily productive man is known and admired throughout the world, and yet virtually unknown to the American youth, reflects the mistreatment meted out to political heretics by the establishment media. That he was black, and in addition a threatening male, intensified his reduction from superhuman to non-person.
So when you're feeling still alone,
Robeson grew up in Princeton, New Jersey, the son of the minister of the Witherspoon Presbyterian Church. At age 60, in his very important political statement, "Here I Stand," Paul Robeson was to reminisce about his father, about the important role of his father in young Paul's search for identity. And I quote him, "As I went out into life, one thing loomed above all else. I was my father's son, a Negro in America. That was the challenge." What was the impact of his father? Robeson lists three very important areas, three very important bits of advice that his father gave him. One, strive for perfection. Attain the highest possible, not in comparison with others, but in terms of one's own capabilities. The result of this was that Robeson was to achieve near perfection in everything he ever did. The second bit of advice from his father was to pursue only worthwhile goals. He was advised to remain loyal to his convictions. And the third bit of advice was to have strong self-confidence. These lessons were to arm Robeson to face the obstacles and to fight the battles that he was to face as he grew up and grew into manhood in racist America. At Rutgers, young Paul had one of the most remarkable four-year undergraduate careers in the history of American education. 2-year Phi Beta Kappa and 2-year football All-American, class valedictorian and four-letter athlete, class day and commencement speaker, and winner of every university oratorical contest for which he was eligible. Ironically, though he was, quote, "the best musical instrument wrought by nature in our time," as one critic remarked, he was not allowed to make the Rutgers Glee Club. And he was to have his nose broken and his fingernails stripped as he tried out for the football team. Robeson became a local folk hero for his work among the black community of New Brunswick and received that community's acknowledgments at a banquet in his honor upon graduation. But let his fellow students speak about him, the third black in Rutgers history, and never was there more than one other black during his entire 4 years at Rutgers. There was praise for him in poetry and prose. The Rutgers literary magazine, Scarlet Letter, contained the following poem to Robeson, dedicated to Robeson. "All hats off to Roby men, all honor to his name. On the diamond court and football field, he's brought old Rutgers fame." But perhaps it's the Targum, June 1919, that sums up his remarkable career. And I quote an editorial entitled, "Paul Leroy Robeson. With the departure of the class of 1919, the Rutgers undergraduate body loses a man who has been for 4 years an active factor in its life. While on the campus, Paul Robeson made a name and a record equaled by none. And now, as he fares forth into the world, we wish him the same success. In the fall of 1915, there was seen among the other freshmen this Negro unheralded and unknown. Soon, however, the ever-watchful eyes of Coach Sanford discovered him, and he made that famous football team. This was the beginning of an athletic career without equal. For 4 years, Robeson has been the star of football teams with enviable records. In basketball, he has played every position as a necessity arose. Again, in baseball and track, has his merit been shown. At the end of his junior year, a four-letter man, he now leaves Rutgers with the Rutgers R awarded to him 11 times. Most athletes are not students, but Roby starred in both. Each year, an honor man, he was elected to the Phi Beta Kappa Society at the end of his third year. A speaker of deep thought and marvelous ability in presentation, he won the class oratorical prize 4 years in succession and was on the varsity debating team. Yet one may combine physical and mental ability and still lack the most important element in one's character, moral stamina. If such be the rule, Robeson is again the exception, proving it, for he is a man through and through. To repeat that, for he is a man through and through. Now, Paul, the Targum continues, as you pass from our midst, take with you the respect and appreciation of those of us who remain behind. May your success in life be comparable to that of your college days. In you, other members of your race may well find a noble example, and this leadership is your new duty. The Targum editorial ends, may Rutgers never forget this noble son, and may he always remember his alma mater. Paul Robeson, Jr. is seen here admiring the abstract sculpture of his father at the Rutgers Student Center, Newark. He sums up his father as a man and as a political man.
My father challenged the cultural, political, and economic foundations of racism in America uncompromisingly. Two, he linked the struggle for black liberation in America with the struggle of the oppressed all over the world and identified the enemy of the world's people, the main enemy, as American imperialism, as you heard. It's in that context, he said, it's unthinkable to him that American Negroes would fight for their oppressors against the Soviet Union. Third, he never allowed his personal success to explain away what happened to his people. Fourth, he survived an unprecedented onslaught. He took all they had to throw at him, came out the other end triumphant, unbowed. His famous comment was, I shall not retreat 1,000th part of an inch. And there's a certain majestic triumph in the fact that he's retired sort of undefeated champion. He never took a word back, and he retired unbowed and undefeated. Lastly, his achievements were so great in so many areas, sort of a superhero of a super American success story.
Robeson had just about as good a mind, body, will, and voice, all in one person, as functioned in the first half of the 20th century. Honored throughout the world as an outstanding drama, film, stage performer, Robeson transferred this artistic prestige to that of a political spokesman on behalf of those seeking to gain and to retain freedom. His friendship with and support of freedom fighters Namande Azikiwe, Jomo Kenyatta, Kwame Nkrumah and Nehru attest to this. To the United States State Department, the House Un-American Activities Committee, the renters of major U.S. concert halls, the National Football Hall of Fame, and numerous Rutgers alumni, his political utterances brought infamy and, from some, cries of disloyalty. So while there is a Mount Paul Robeson in the USSR, a Paul Robeson archives in the German Democratic Republic, and an international Stalin Peace Prize in his possession, his own government would not even allow him a passport to go abroad to practice his profession. Entrepreneurs denied him the privilege of singing in the Carnegie Halls of America for 8 long years. Robeson decided he could no longer support a political economic system, the U.S. political and economic system, even though with Joe Lewis he had actively supported the United States war efforts against fascism during World War II. He had recruited, he had publicly justified, and he had entertained troops at military installations and workers at defense plants. Robeson was in the vanguard of significant developments in black political and intellectual assertion. In the 1930s, he was an intellectual forerunner in scholarly publications on African heritage, culture, and linguistics.
You have anything left in our American life from our native Africa? Well, this is a pretty good illustration. You said in Nigerian, okay, you say first, okay, the melee, and ye not follow up, okay, the melee. The melody's almost the same. Okay, the melee, okay, the melee. This and a hammer, kill John and me say, kill John and me, can't kill me. Yeah, we saved it down in Alabama from way back in Nigeria.
His warning to President Truman in 1946 that unless the U.S. government began to protect black Americans from lynchings, blacks would take the necessary steps of armed self-defense. This preceded the teachings of Malcolm X, Nation of Islam, Robert Williams, the Deacons for Justice, and the Black Panthers. Robeson had a concrete liberation program. His proposed tactics of using two mass-based organizations, the churches and the labor unions, under black leadership, was an important contribution to black political thought. Except for implicit criticism of Booker T. Washington and an unnamed but obvious minister observer at Bandung in 1955, Robeson was careful not to condemn any black spokesman. Implicit and explicit in his pronouncements and in his actions was his belief in the overwhelming need for black unity in issues for which there could be unity. Robeson's political evolution took several steps. From experiencing racial exploitation in the United States, he began to see class exploitation on the Liverpool docks and in the Welsh coal mines. After personally experiencing a near lynch at the Friedrichstrasse railroad station in Hitler's Germany, Robeson was deeply moved by the warm reception he received in the Soviet Union. Both from the political and artistic elites and from the general population. The great Soviet filmmaker Sergei Eisenstein welcomed him at the Moscow train station. People were to greet him wherever he walked. These personal experiences and observations were to aid his attraction to the USSR and his subsequent identification with scientific socialism. He later became a confidant of the head of the Soviet government and party, Nikita Khrushchev, long before any American president was to meet Chairman Khrushchev. Here you see Paul Robeson, Mrs. Robeson, Chairman Khrushchev, and Walter Ulbricht, former party and government head of the German Democratic Republic, relaxing at Khrushchev's dacha on the Black Sea. Widespread but false myths exist about Robeson in relationship to communism and to the USSR. Perhaps this is a good time to clear them up. Number one, Robeson was never a member of the Communist Party, joining only one political organization his entire life, the Council on African Affairs. He co-founded the council, which concerned itself with American liberation, African liberation from colonialism and imperialism, before being politically smeared into oblivion. Number two, he did not exile himself to the USSR, but was in fact kept from leaving the United States for 8 years. His extended residence abroad was in fact in England. Robeson credited several international conditions with making the time ripe for black liberation in the United States. One was the emergence of anti-fascist, anti-colonialist, and anti-capitalist political systems and economic systems in China and the USSR. Two was the mere existence of the USSR as potential military political protector and as a model for economic and cultural development. Three was the rise to self-assertion of African and Asian peoples from European domination, as evidenced by their growing self-articulation at the 1955 Bandung Conference. The essence of Robeson's evolution as a man can be seen in his changing of the lyrics of Oscar Hammerstein's Old Man River. Early in his artistic career, Robeson was to sing it as written. You get a little drunk and you lands in jail. I gets weary and sick of trying. I'm tired of living and scared of dying.
You and me, we sweat and strain, body all aching and racked with pain. Told that bot, live that tale, you get a little drunk and you land in jail. I feel weary and sick of crying, I'm tired of living and scared of dying.
His later message to the world's oppressed with whom he identified and to the oppressors for whom he had scorn is summed up by the significant changes. You show a little grit and you land in jail. I must keep fighting until I'm dying. He dared assert his manhood and that of his people. That is how Robeson responded to racism, whether it be in the classroom, on the football field, in the political arena, on the stage, in the concert hall, or on the screen.
You and me, we sweat and strain, body all aching and racked with pain. Tote that budge and lift that nail, you show a little grit and you land.
just keep